Welcome to our breakout session, Future of Work. It's great to see all of you here to talk about this topic that has always been an important topic, but has gotten some renewed attention as of late. My name's Josh Mendelson, and I'm pleased to introduce my fellow panelists here. We have Donna Harris, co-founder of 1776, entrepreneur in her own right, PR guru among public affairs guru, among many, many other things. We have Lori Sanders, who's senior fellow and outreach director at the R Street Institute. We have Kristen Sharp, who's the executive director of, and let me get this right, New America and Bloomberg's joint initiative, Shift the Commission on Work, Workers, and Technology. You get that?
That's right.
All right, and a startup consultant and longtime Senate staff. And then we have Rick Lane, who most recently led public affairs for 20th Century Fox, and is making a special appearance here soon after deciding to leave Fox. So it's really nice to have him. Maybe just to set up a little bit of what we're talking about, you know, future of work has meant a lot of things to a lot of people. And so the folks that you see up here have actually been working on it quite a bit before November. And so for a lot of us, it was something that we dove into when we were talking about the 1099 economy. What did we do when we were thinking about contract versus full-time labor? But obviously, politics has put more attention on this, where we found that, you know, in a recent confirmation hearing where Wilbur Ross, who's President Trump's nominee for Commerce, actually called out the displacement that will occur for truck drivers as we have self-driving trucks, and the number of workers in the sector of the economy that would be disrupted. At the same time at Davos, we had the CEO of Microsoft and the co-founder of Google both talk about what the future of AI would mean for workforces, and frankly, how both of them were surprised by how destabilizing AI could be and how fast artificial intelligence went from being sort of a figment of computer science is now something that's really quite real and upon us. And so, you know, we want to hear from all of you with lots of questions today. So just right up front, I want to ask, please ask a question if you're going to give us a statement. I learned a great phrase. If you're going to give us a statement in your perspective anyway, at least phrase it as a question. So thank you for that, Lori. But nevertheless, I think the format here is I'll pose a couple of questions to our panel, let them answer, and then please feel free to engage, and we'll try to keep this as interactive as humanly possible. So maybe with that, just to get us started, many of you may have seen there was a piece in the New York Times that was released, I believe, the New Yorker yesterday, that talked a little bit about how in Silicon Valley the idea of being a prepper, right, of creating doomsday scenarios is actually really popular. And when you read through it, you find out that a lot of Silicon Valley executives believe that there will eventually be revolt and that they will be vulnerable because they have created the automation that has displaced workers. At the same time, you had Bloomberg Businessweek put out a story yesterday that noted that of all of the jobs that seem to be displaced, they seem to disproportionately affect women. And so, you know, let's just dive right into it. Not going to pick on anyone in particular, so maybe I'll find a volunteer. Is this problem real? Are we overreacting? And if it is real, what are we seeing and why do you think it's real?
Well, I'll jump in. I do think it's real. As we think about where we are, we're one foot in the industrial era, one foot in the digital era, and success as a country means successfully navigating that transition. And if we look at the jobs base, right, just look within the private employment sector, the top 100 private employers, somewhere around 16 million employees, right? They're in jobs that are retail and food, and they're manual intensive, and you can easily imagine those jobs being automated. Right, go into a Walmart and have an experience with a checker and someone who's checking your receipt when you walk out the door to make sure you paid for that thing that's in your bag. All of those things can be automated, and you're talking about a number that's two times the current number of unemployed people we have in our country. Right, so it's a very real challenge. And I think we've seen the beginning of the anger around the uncertainty. We were talking earlier about how little people can diagnose, right? They feel the symptoms of what's going on, but if you go and you meet, as I have the last 90 days on a listening tour, and you go and you meet with people who live in the heartland and who are feeling these things, they don't know how to then diagnose what they're feeling, and prescribe an action for themselves. In fact, they don't even think they have to take personal action. They're waiting for some universal they to fix it for them. And if you unpack that, that means problems of personal agency and the fact that they don't realize they have to understand this transition. They don't realize that the skills they have need to be changed, and it's their responsibility to do that. And all of this manifests itself potentially in massive conflict as people look at summits like Davos, and if you look at the backlash against the, you know, the elites, there's culture clash and there's class clash that inevitably, if we don't get in front of this, and we do have an opportunity to get in front of this, so you know, buying a second home and in some doomsday prepper scenario and stockpiling, you know, sardines in my basement isn't the answer. The answer is let's get in front of it, right? We don't need that to be the guaranteed future. We can figure out solutions to this stuff if we just start experimenting with potential answers. So it's real, but it's not inevitable that it becomes chaos.
I was just saying, you know, my thought is what I call the Uber rich versus the Uber driver. You know, it's the kind of impact of autonomous vehicles on the American middle class. And I think you heard it in the testimony about transportation. And I think that's one of the symptoms that you see. But the other thing that you have to realize that there are other factors that are out there as well. You know, as a lobbyist, you know, I always give an analogy, what is a lobbyist? I say it's a weatherman, a pool salesman, and a taxi driver. If you want to know about the pool salesman, taxi driver, I'll tell you after. But the weatherman is, our job is to predict storms. What's going to impact my company, our sector? What's happening out there? So yeah, you have the the automation and the artificial intelligence, but you also have these gaps of wealth that are being created. You're seeing a slowdown in employee productivity growth for the first time, not just in the United States, but across, you know, almost 31 industrial countries around the world. But what's also troubling that you see is that there are approximately 10 million Americans, according to Nicholas Eberstadt's book, that are no longer looking for work. And they are now spending 21.7 hours of their week watching TV, video games, and unfortunately alcohol and drugs. The other is you have the growth of IoT, the Internet of Things. I also am concerned about the impact of virtual reality addiction. I think when your life is horrible and they're already watching TV and playing video games, imagine a world where you look really good and you have everything's perfect. You know, why wouldn't I rather be in that world than the real world? And then you have ubiquitous broadband. So there are a lot of other factors that are coming. And my biggest concern, though, getting back to the truck drivers and the Uber rich versus the Uber driver, is autonomous vehicles and what will happen to approximately 7 million people who are out there driving trucks today who are making good livings. They're not all going to be coders. They're not, you know, someone can teach me how to sing, but I'll never be a professional singer, no matter how much I try and how much I would like to do that. But what you have is a situation of a group of folks coming into the workplace or already in the workplace, what I call the unemployable. It's not that they don't want to work. They're not like the 10 million who have just given up. They're not just unemployed, but they're no longer employable. And those unemployable join the ranks of those 10 million could completely undermine our society. So when, you know, for me, this has been what I call one of my passion projects, because I see a lot of clouds developing that are not good for where we're heading. And yes, I do fear the revolt. I do fear the backlash. You just look what happens with Amazon right now. They're being, you know, demonized of what they're doing to American jobs. You know, rightly or wrongly, they are. And that backlash, as people start looking for scapegoats, right now it's trade, but trade is not a problem. It's really your jobs are going in a different direction.
Yeah, if I can follow up on some of those threads, I think the, can everyone hear me okay?
I think the car issue and the coming, you know, driverless car revolution actually in many ways encapsulates in one small snippet what the larger problem is. So, you know, I'm from Georgia originally, which is a state that saw its sort of textiles and manufacturing and many jobs go away over the last few decades. And then has made a huge effort, right, over the last 10, 15 years to really bring high-skilled manufacturing back onshore. And they've been wildly successful in doing so, right? But each of those plants doesn't bring back as many jobs as the ones that went away. And so, you know, we've talked to different, you know, manufacturers down there, and they say, well, we frequently decide to invest in robotics rather than invest in human capital. And it's not because we don't want to invest in human capital, it's because our human capital is underprepared. And so what did they do as a result? The state of Georgia said, well, this is a huge problem. And so we're going to launch what I actually think was pretty forward thinking, and give the governor a lot of credit for this, what they called the High Demand Career Initiative, where they went around and actually talked to employers and said, well, what is it that you need? How could we get you? How could we make our humans competitive with robotics, right? Because we don't want to fear the, you know, coming robotic revolution, but we do want humans to be competitive. We want to make sure we're educating them in the right ways. And so they reached out to find out what the most in-demand careers possibly were and how could they get more people into them. And like is typical for many of these states that are bringing back high school manufacturing, what they saw was it was a lot of welding and lo and behold, a lot of semi-truck drivers. And so they've made a huge investment in preparing people to be semi-truck drivers. When we all know that probably in the next 20 years, those people are gonna not have employable skills in Georgia's economy anymore. And so I do think it's a huge question. And the displacement is real. You can already see it happening in the choice for robotics in factories. And it's going to continue to happen as technology changes and becomes, you know, cheaper and easier for people and companies to incorporate. I think the way that you stem that revolution, right, it's not that we should fear these technologies or we should fear these changes. It's that we have to refocus and reshape. It's such a complicated question once you start thinking about it. It could be higher education reform. It could be helping people be more geographically mobile and move to areas where their skills might be better suited. It's a question about disability insurance. You know, we've created this huge system where people are disincentivized from working once their skills no longer match the workforce if they can claim some sort of disability. So it gets really complicated really quickly, but as Donna said, these are questions that we can see coming now, and I think we still have time to address them, but as 2016 would show us, we need to address them sooner rather than later.
My perspective is slightly different. I run a project that looks at the impact of automation, artificial intelligence, the on-demand economy, and other technologies that provide jobs on sort of jobs and the ultimate ramifications for society. And we've tried very hard in the Shift project to be agnostic about whether or not automation and coming technologies will be good for people or bad for people and in what circumstances. And one of the linking, we run economic scenario planning exercises where people from cities throughout the country come together across disciplines in the tech world, in the finance world, in the social advocacy world and policymaking world, at all levels of government, and sort of game out what they think the future of jobs in society will look like 15 to 20 years from now. And one of the major linking factors across all of the scenarios that any group in any sector brainstorms is that the jobs that are in growth areas and industries are all self-directed jobs. We're moving from a situation in which someone or some authority assigns you work to work that you need to create for yourself and opportunities that you need to find for yourself. And so all of the things that are the remaining jobs will either be human-centered jobs related to care or strategy, or the things that sort of manage the automated systems in the retail world or the transportation world or things like that. And so retraining people to a self-directed focus and to looking for opportunities is just a different orientation than what we've had in our education system, in our workforce, and sort of our trajectory of economic advancement in this country. And so thinking about it in that sense is there are many opportunities for people. You have to sort of know where to find them and look for them and create them.
So maybe, Kristen, are we just rehashing an old debate now with the lens of Uber and AI, but really this is no different than when we thought ATMs were going to eliminate bank tellers?
Well, I think the differences would be in the scale and pace. I mean, when we've had major changes before the agriculture to the Industrial Revolution and things like that, it's been over the course of a longer period of time, whereas now we're getting to the point where machine intelligence can teach itself, and the major difference is that it's using data and connectivity in a different and new way, and because of that, it's constantly building on its own capabilities. So, you know, people have to learn how to react to that and quickly. And so I think that may be one of the differences.
Just, you know, I always hear a lot from the content industry, so we were always the Luddites, you know, not adapting, and everyone would always talk about how, you know, in the Industrial Revolution, we no longer manufacture the horse and buggy carriages anymore, and those people went out of and lost jobs. The big difference, and this is what scares me the most, is during the Industrial Revolution, I get to finally use my history major, but during the Industrial Revolution, you had one horse and buggy manufacturer was very skilled, being replaced by thousands of uneducated farmers and folks coming from overseas to these massive factories where you didn't really need to have a high level of education. What we're seeing now is the complete reverse, which is that you have massive amount of people losing jobs to the pyramid going the other way, where you have many going to one, and the one is high-skilled, highly educated, you know, Silicon Valley engineers coming out of MIT, but there's nothing down here for the people coming from the farms. And the questions that we have to address is, how do we deal with those that are not being addressed? One place to look at is venture capital, right? Why don't we have more jobs, venture capital? But how many people here have heard of what a unicorn is? For those who haven't raised their hand, unicorns are companies valued at $1 billion or above that have not yet gone public. If you look at the unicorn list that's out there, from what I was able to tell, and please correct me if I'm wrong, I saw one manufacturing company, and it was SpaceX. And I believe me, low-level people are not working the factory floors at SpaceX. Every one of the billion plus, all the way up to companies like, you know, Lyft and Uber, are all at the corporate level, at the inside the corporate level, engineering jobs. And there's plenty of those, H-1B visa shortages, all those things. But what we don't have is any venture capital or try to get a bank loan to build a factory. You're not going to get it. And so the question is, what type of economic incentives are we creating businesses to create those types of jobs that allow for people who are not educated at the engineering level to find a productive place to work? And it's not just about income distribution, but it's about being productive in society. As you always heard from my parents, idle hands cause mischief. And I'm very concerned that there are going to be too many idle hands 10, 15 years from now if we don't address this today.
But you're not making an argument that some in Silicon Valley make around universal basic income is the
I don't think that's practical, and I don't think it's, you know, I look at that as income redistribution. It may be helpful, but it doesn't solve the problem of creating jobs. It's sort of, you know, I grew up in Hollywood, you know, sort of, let's, you know, throw more money at the problem. That's not what people want. What people want is to work. They don't want just to be handed money. Look what happens in Alaska and how those dollars are being utilized. You know, it's not always the most efficient use of resources. So I hear that idea. It makes you feel good because you're giving all your billions of dollars of wealth to people who need it. And yes, there needs to be safety nets and other type of economic ways to help people out. Don't get me wrong. But just income redistribution or this universal wage idea, universal income, I think is a disaster if we pursue that.
Maybe to push on that a bit harder, Rick, where would you draw the line between universal basic income, which is really quite what it is, having, you know, the wealthy provide more of their capital to those who are less fortunate, to government incentive structures to create more businesses of a particular type?
Well, I think one of the ways is to try to create incentives for to hire more employees versus what we have currently in the corporate tax structure, which is to buy more machines. If you look at the tax code and the bonus depreciation tax is about buying more machines. The theory is if you buy more machines, hire more people to build those machines. But if those machines are being built by robotics, then that doesn't help the employee. So we have to think. I have a whole list of different ideas. They all have to work together. Mine are not perfect, and I'm happy to argue on every single one of them. But the fact is we really need to have this discussion today, else we're going to have a huge social problem in the future.
I have a little bit of a different perspective from that for two reasons. And one, I think that the inherent concept of a job creator or incentivizing or giving someone money to create jobs for others is itself inherently a product of the system that we used to have for work rather than the new economy structure. And rather than thinking about ways to continue to create jobs for other people, we need to be thinking much more carefully about how to help much more diverse and broad sectors segments of society identify opportunities for themselves and be able to move into those opportunities for themselves, whether that's, you know, diversity work, whether that's training women and minorities for, you know, how to pitch an idea, go forward with it, whether it is access to capital for people who don't traditionally have it. All of those things need to happen, but it's an empowering people to create their own opportunities rather than a giving it to them. And then the second reason, real quickly, that I think it's different is that I don't know that going forward 15 to 20 years from now, we'll even structure jobs how we have them right now. And right even now, 30% of people get some portion of their income from a non-traditional job, something that's not a 9-to-5 job, whether it's in the gig economy, in the contingent workforce more broadly, whether it's several different part-time jobs, whether it's project basis, all of those things are happening in our economy, and you want to figure out a way to make that, to transition that from being a situation where people are scraping by to a situation where that's empowering them to make choices that they want to make in their work life.
Yeah, I could not agree more with that. And I think fundamentally, as you look at reports coming out of Davos and potential solutions that people are proposing, there's a fundamental flaw in most of them, which is that they're putting the institution at the center rather than realizing that this entire shift is about the deinstitutionalization of everything, right? And it's about what does that mean in terms of reconnecting the economy in a way where the individual is at the center. And community with a little c is at the center, right? A community could be a neighborhood, a book club, a friendship circle, a church community. You can see that emerging in how some of the most promising and successful tech companies have grown, right? If you just take the sort of Uber example that we were talking about, right? They didn't ask for permission to go do that. They just started doing it. And what I found in my research in the last 90 days, and we were comparing notes earlier, the sense of personal agency is missing because we've built a society over the last 100 years that is industrial. It's about the big system. I go and I get my job at a big school, and then I go to a big university, and then I go work for a big employer, and we have big government, and they take care of it. And I'm a little cog in a very big system. We're flipping that entire thing around with the digital era. You're now a cog alongside every other cog, and you get to decide how you reassemble that system for yourself. The problem is that we don't have that as a skill as a country, because we went to school to learn how to follow directions. We're very good at taking tests and getting the right answer and being able to regurgitate it. But when you think about what does it mean to be entrepreneurial, it doesn't mean go start a business. It means be able to be a thinker around problems. Be able to ask why not or why, and unbundle and unpack it and rethink the way something is done. But I can tell you from the last 6 years of my experience working with entrepreneurs all over the world, there's an entrepreneurial gene that's lacking that we need to relearn as a country. Comfort with discord, comfort with uncertainty, being able to reimagine new possibilities. And we're going to be in for a lot of trouble if we just try to reimagine the new economy, keeping the institution at the center of the wheel.
I think as a threshold matter, all of us up here are willing to acknowledge that there's a historic displacement occurring, something that's a little bit beyond what we've seen. And so let's take it a step further, building off of Donna, what you've said, and Rick, what you said with some of Kristen's data. What obligation do we have as folks who are part of the current tech sector, right, or part of this newer economy? What obligations do we bear to see to it that our country can succeed in this transformation, or frankly, that our world and the worldwide workforce?
Well, fundamentally, we're all human, right? At the end of the day, if you look at the challenge that we have with charity and the challenge we have with institutional solutions, it presupposes that I have a solution I'm going to bring to you. And if only I can bring my smarts into your community and get you to do what I want you to do, we can solve the problem. We have to flip that around and understand that fundamentally, every one of us is a human being. We care about our families. We care about our futures. Employment is a key part. Job, the ability to care for yourself and your family, is a key thing that we all have inherent in our DNA. And so we can't say it to ourselves as tech leaders, let me just go create this company and not worry about the impact, because you can see there's some massive unintended consequences from some of the greatest technologies and companies that we've seen. And you certainly can say, okay, we'll let the chips fall where they fall, but that's how revolt happens. That's how national chaos and discord happens. We can be a part of the solution, if only because of our self-interest that we want to prevent that sort of revolt happening in the country. But I appeal to the higher moral instinct. I challenge you to go and spend a week in cities across America, as I've done, and meet with people. There are smart people everywhere, and they really do want to work. They want jobs. They want to take care of themselves and their families. They just don't have a framework for being able to do that. They don't have the tools to do that. And frankly, in many cases, they're not connected to the networks that they need to be successful. And in a networked economy, being disconnected from the network is literally the kiss of death. So these are things that we have a moral obligation to be helpful to our fellow man. And if we see the coming off of the Trump election, whether you're for him or against him, there's emotions on both sides that say something is wrong. Let's come alongside our fellow man and figure out how we fix it. That's appealing to the moral nature in all of us.
So I completely agree with all of that. And I think it's larger than just a question, too, of what the tech sector can do, although I am aware that we're here at a tech conference. But I think one of the reasons that this has happened over the last several decades is that business in general hasn't stepped up. It's not necessarily this one tech actor or that one manufacturing actor. But, you know, as we've seen the decline of unions and a lot of the sort of traditional bonds that would bring people together, help them find employment, help them get the skills that they need, give them a seal of approval, you know, that they're going to be a good employee. That's really gone away, right? And I mean, I come from a sort of conservative bent. I'm not up here exactly bemoaning the downfall of unions. I think they came with plenty of problems as well. But it left a gap, right? And it's a gap that's not really well filled right now by our higher education system. Like we've pointed out multiple times on this panel, there's a problem not just in getting the skills training that we need and then the upskilling that you need to continue to be successful in work, but it starts in high school and it starts in elementary school and how we teach our children to tackle problems. And I think that that's a place where all businesses can really play, right? Whether it's partnering with community colleges or working with high schools to develop curricula to help people have the skills that they need both in a character sense and in a skills sense to tackle the problems that they're going to face in the future. That would be my number one priority, because then it doesn't matter whether you are going into a traditional job. If you find a spot in some firm where you're one of 1,000 employees, you're going to have the grit that that employer wants to be successful and move up, or you'll have the grit that you need to go out and decide how you're going to assemble work for yourself. These are basic human characteristics, like Donna said, that I think we have let sort of flounder, and we really need to reinvoke. And I think that there's a lot we can do, particularly in education, to help people get there. But it requires, I think, people wanting to dig in and provide that programming or provide the partnerships, or, you know, it could take a variety of forms. And then secondly, I think that there's plenty that we can do in terms of lobbying for things like reduced occupational licensing restrictions, making sure that we stand on the right side of trade, knowing that people who are going to be entrepreneurs and work for themselves are going to want to sell their products globally, and we want to provide every single one of those people, even if they compete with us, with the biggest marketplace possible. So I think sort of defending good business principle too will be incredibly important over the next 4-8 years.
I agree, and there's nothing that I'm saying that says we shouldn't be entrepreneurial. I mean, I started leading recruiting software for college and university sports programs back in 94 using digital technologies and digital video. And so I think that's all great. The questions, what I'm saying is we have to ask ourselves some serious questions. You know, are we going to go to, you know, from a full-time, full benefits type world to where you have companies like Uber say, Obamacare is a great thing because it provides freedom, and so the burden's now placed on the workers. That's a policy question, and these are the questions that we have to ask ourselves. But we also have to ask ourselves really this fundamental question is, what do we want to do in terms of getting folks ready for this? If we're not prepared, if we're not ready, then I think we're going to find ourselves in a world of hurt. And for companies, you know, it's interesting, as Luddites is the industry I came from, if you ever watched a movie, everybody after the title of the movie, when you watch the credits go by, are all independent contractors. They do not have an employer. They do not work for Fox or Time Warner or anybody. They go from job to job to job to job. So our industry, you know, the Luddites, have been doing independent contractors successfully for a very long time, along with having a corporate, you know, venture capital firm, which we call 20th Century Fox. But those two things are not mutually exclusive. And so you can have hybrid worlds where you do have protections of healthcare benefits and pensions and things like that if we're willing to reorganize our society, but we're just not there yet.
I think that kind of goes to what Lori was saying earlier, though, because in that world of Hollywood, USA, I mean, those people are represented by collective bargaining organizations. And so there is a fundamental structure under them and a fundamental structure that we don't have now in the world of independent contracting workers, because nothing has stepped into that void of, you know, now that union representation is down to 6% rather than 30%, there's nothing that's advocating for a larger group of people among the different circumstances, and I'm agnostic about what that should be, whether that is new guilds, that is new forms of, you know, worker organizations, whether that's collections of industry leaders that set benchmarks and best practices among the industries. But I think something needs to go into that void, certainly. I also think that we're just in a situation in which people across, like, that you can be entrepreneurial in any, you know, socioeconomic category and in any sector, but you need to have the tools to use that to some end. And one of the things that I hear the most frequently in going across the country and talking about this stuff is that people used to feel like they had a specific area of expertise in any job, in any part of society, and in any industry. And now much of the different tasks that are out there are replaceable and interchangeable, and people don't have a new way to express their expertise and specialization. So in the digital world, we're gonna have to figure out some system and process for allowing people to identify digitally that I'm good at X, I wanna take over this kind of project, I wanna do this kind of work so that they can advance on that front.
If I could add one more thing to build on part of what Kristen said. You know, one of the things that we've advocated for at R Street, particularly as it relates to the gig economy and what we're going to do, whether there's a third status or what evolves in the future. So we've advocated repeatedly for whether it's a safe harbor or a period where you can experiment. You know, we actually wrote a piece with Andy Stern, of all people, and it was a fantastic piece. I encourage you to read it. I didn't write it, so I can say that. That asked for, you know, periods of labor law waiver so that there could be experimentation to figure out how companies want to offer benefits, how people want to seek benefits, whether that's training or insurance or whatever. An important part of that being successful is companies wanting to step into the game, right? I mean, we would all look like fools if we said, give these companies 5 years to work with the state and local governments, to work with local workforce boards, with local unions. They're going to come up with something really awesome that we could never just prescribe from on high on Washington right now based on the information we have. But they're going to come up with the solution that will help bring us into the future. Well, companies are gonna have to wanna be at that table. And clearly we've seen, you know, some interest. Obviously Uber has some interesting arrangements in New York City, and I know is pursuing more ideas. Etsy's put out proposals for what a benefit structure should look like, although it's a little bit government-centric for my liking. But there needs to be more of that, right? If we wanna think about what tech companies can do, then it's going out on that limb to say, here's what we would like to provide and how we would like to work with people and help them advance themselves if we were free from many of these other burdens.
But that gets to, I think, one of the really important points about everything that we're talking about, which is that no one has the answer right now. We've gotta look at everything from education, higher ed, job retraining, workforce restructuring, benefits, entrepreneurship, you name it, we've got to look at it. And we don't have the answer in any one of those areas. What we have to do is get good at experimenting as opposed to having opinions. I have opinions about whether universal basic income will work or won't, but we just should try it, right? If you think about entrepreneurs and the way that we approach startups, right, I might think my startup idea is awesome. You might think it's terrible. Right. We all have opinions about things, but what we tell entrepreneurs is to go put an MVP together, a minimum viable product, and test it and see what the reaction is. Let's look at the data. Does it actually work or doesn't it work? And so getting into a place where, you know, this great American pivot that we're facing can be one that we have a culture of experimentation as opposed to a culture of opinion on social media, we need to launch a million experiments, and we need to keep the ones that work and throw out the ones that don't work, but keep that sort of experimentation process going.
Yeah, I agree with that. And I think if Silicon Valley wants to start a universal, you know, income, they can fund it and have, you know, and do that with the foundation. You know, there's a question, is it going to be mandatory from the government's perspective, or is it going to be an experiment and voluntary that folks who want to try that experiment can go ahead and find a population and do that? So I'm, you know, my chamber hat goes on a little bit very quickly when I hear sort of income redistribution.
Yeah, well, and it turns out Y Combinator, the sort of famous Silicon Valley incubator, is totally running a UBI pilot, right? Maybe I'm not supposed to have hints. I mean, I think it just reeks of hubris, but
but let's try it.
We should try it, right? I subscribe to Donna's perspective. I would go further now that I've clearly decided I'm going to have an opinion here. Like, I would go further that in arguing that from my perspective, which is definitely more on the entrepreneurial end, that a lot of these things have solutions found if we're sufficiently entrepreneurial. You know, I've argued that I actually think that there's a lot of opportunity for somebody to actually get quite wealthy by figuring out how to use underutilized labor and helping it be more productive.
Or solve the union problem. What's the new economy version of a union? Someone's going to create something and make $1 billion.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so, you know, I think it's the point that almost everyone's making, which is, you know, perhaps the fundamental solution we all agree on is the first solution, which is let's create more freedom for experimentation, right? Trying to find new ways to innovate in a very rapidly changing economy.
We also can't ignore the fact of what I call the hyper network effect. There are some companies at the top of the food chain that are becoming dominant just because of the nature of the net itself and the nature of the importance of data and how that works. And that does have to be looked at. You can't just say it doesn't exist. All you have to say is GAFA in the EU, and they know what you're talking about. And so, for those who don't, Google, Amazon, Facebook, and Apple. There is concerns out there, and those concerns of being articulated by GAFA as an acronym in the rest of the world is also a problem, because then you start having people creating e-commerce trade barriers, right? And we see that going, data location issues and a bunch of other problems that occur worldwide. So addressing these issues, not just within the United States, but around the world to alleviate those concerns and understanding that those fears are real, and they're concerned about their own companies, their own jobs, their own local stores. We do have to address that, else you will have a perception problem that becomes reality, which triggers a negative reaction that none of us want to see.
This is probably as good a time as any to offer to take first questions. We've got two. Wow, we got a lot. All right, so we'll start with the back left here. So the gentleman with the beard with your hand up still. Who's looking around while still holding his hand up?
Can I wait for a microphone or can I just go for it?
I think you better just go for it. Oh, there's a microphone somewhere? Great.
Hi, my name is, it's working, yes. My name is Andrea Glorioso. I work at the delegation of the European Union to the US here in Washington. But for the record, whatever opinion there might be, my question is not the view of the European Union. It's my personal observation. And in fact, I have a question for the panel. This was extremely interesting, especially for a European. As a European, I would say that, yes, we do need to experiment more, and yes, we need to be more entrepreneurial. How do you design the kind of experiment that you're talking about in labor law, in social welfare, in you name it, that scale at the national and continental level? It's relatively easy to design a system like the ones we're talking about, the scale at the city level, already moving from the city to the state level in your case is much more difficult, one. And secondly, how do you get the buy-in of your own citizens who by and large don't like to be experimented on? So you need to have the buy-in of those citizens. When on the other side you have somebody, and for the record, I'm not thinking about a person in particular, but you have somebody who tells you, don't bother about that, I have the solution. Even if the solution is clearly idiotic, but still you have to deal with those people. Certainly, as in democracies, you have to have the debate. So how do you design experiments that have any chance of succeeding and then being turned into actual reality?
I think that's an interesting question, but I think the answer is that you don't design experiments to do that. That you take small things that are happening at the ground level in cities, in communities, in areas of the country that are experiencing different kinds of displacement, and look at what they are doing and the things that are being led by local businesses, the things that are being led by local industries springing up, and then try to introduce those things to other parts of the country that might have a similar perspective, rather than from the top down saying, here's the experiment that we've all done and here's the answer that we've all come to.
That's right. It's all about just curating thousands of experiments and letting them run their course and creating a mechanism for highlighting both those that are succeeding and those that are failing, community to community, person to person. And it's really fascinating when you do that, how that gets picked up. On a micro example, we saw this work with Startup America, right? So an initiative, the Startup America Partnership, which was the private sector corollary for the public sector initiative, to create strong startup communities outside of Silicon Valley. And it was very similar. Nobody really knew what does it take to create a startup community, but what we knew is there were smart entrepreneurs in every city. And so the thesis was, what if I could just connect them all to one another, let them experiment in their home cities, and the successful experiments get replicated through that network. And it turned out that worked really, really well. And if you look at some of the most successful programs that have been launched, whether they're incubators, accelerators, new venture capital funds, programs outside of Silicon Valley, at their root, you will find a Startup America person who was part of that original network. So, well, in many cases, success is you tried something and it didn't work, and now we know it, we can eliminate that. Right? Or success, you have to look at the data, right? So in many cases, it's about hard data. In some cases, about culture change, right? There's no single answer, right? So you really want to just unleash people to pick the part of the problem that they're passionate about and give them the freedom to try things and then surface the things that are actually working so that if it works, others can try it.
I think as it comes to, you know, getting cities to want to engage, the problem that I've heard most frequently in talking to people who are engaged in this type of work is just the time constraint, right? We all shouldn't ignore that lots of cities are horridly understaffed, right? That everyone's pulled in a different direction, you know, thousands of different directions. And it's, you know, hard for them to find the time, I think, in their day to sit down and say, I'm going to tackle this problem head on and come up with a solution. But I think, again, that comes back to your earlier question about what business can do, what civil society can do, what nonprofits can do. I think that business, it's not that cities don't want to experiment, it's that they don't have the, you know, time and resources to figure out how to make that possible. But when you come to them with a solution, and I know that sometimes city councils can be intractable and they don't necessarily want to do this from the get-go, but there are countless examples of, you know, persistent entrepreneurs or persistent nonprofits, persistent business community members that have gone in and said, this is what we want to try, whether it's a housing policy or anything like that. And you know, with you, when you present it frequently enough, it's easy to, over time, get people on board, but you have to be able to bring to them, you know, like, here's a what I think is like a ready solution. We have partners that are ready to support you. You're not going to face backlash from your voters, or, you know, you have to think through all of those calculations. But I think they're eager to try. It's just a matter of helping them get started sometimes.
I actually didn't mean just city government. I meant anyone in a city acting.
Yeah. I just think that you need to, you know, elected officials are elected officials, and they have a tough job of trying to make people happy. It's the hardest job, I think, in the world to be an elected official, to be quite honest. You're not gonna, you know, 50% are going to be angry at you at any given time. But it really is, I think, more on the business community, working with the labor unions and working with others out there in the training, the NGOs, to try to come up with these experiments. Because if we wait for government to come up with any answers or take that risk, we'll be waiting for a long time and we'll be in a crisis situation. So it's really incumbent about the people who are outside of government to start looking at what they can do to take the important steps and investment, training, and other types of experiments. And not wait for government. Just make sure that you're not violating any rules or laws and going to jail for it.
Let's move on to the next question. I'm totally going to take the moderator's privilege here and add it, my own thought, which is I don't think it's a zero-sum game, and I also don't think that this is a double-blind, you know, trial with placebos where somebody's going to lose, right? So the more you try, you can try things in parallel. You can try multiple things at once, and the outcomes, you know, some will work better than others, but the chance that it produces zero productive gain is really quite low. Right, so my sort of view on this is, like, let's try a lot of things at once. Sorry, the gentleman in purple. you've had your hand up for a little bit.
Thanks. Jonathan Zook from the Innovators Network. I feel like everyone on the panel is operating on this sort of underlying assumption that the answer here is actually going to lie in employment itself. And I'm not speaking against your point, Donna, but there's this idea that somehow it's about finding the right ways to for people to find the right place for them to be, to utilize their time, et cetera, in some form that feels like employment of their time, I guess is what I mean. And if I were to posit some corollary to Moore's law, it's that there is an inverse exponential relationship between automation and job availability. And so, the fact that automating cash registers at a grocery store has led to a job getting created to help people when they're confused by the machines, it created one job that replaced eight of them. And so we start talking about education. I wonder, do we need to have more of a vision for what the ultimate future is going to be and work backward from that rather than sort of band-aiding forward, which is what a lot of this, in addition to this, I don't mean instead of, but in addition to this, what is the vision going forward? I think of the movie Logan's Run or something like that, right? What does this world look like? And is education about everybody needing to think less about their self-worth coming from work? And work itself is something that we're going to have to redefine, as it might be art or music or something like that, because the jobs are simply not going to be there, even if we manage to turn everyone into programmers.
Right. I think the entire concept of job, work, value, worth, use of your gifts, all get reimagined in the new era. And any assumption that we're making based on the framework of the last 100 years, we need to be very cognizant of where we're assuming something that is true today will remain true tomorrow. And
I build on that from having run now several different economic scenario planning situations where people truly do just brainstorm what they think the world will look like 20 years from now. And it's come up a shocking amount that we need to think about ways to revalue care. And with an aging population in this country, how do we make caring for elderly relatives or neighbors or whatever a valued part of our society? How do we think through those things? And I've been shocked at this group of very high level CEOs or people who are leaders in their local communities who have been thinking very carefully about this.
And if you think about the industrial era, right, pre-industrial, we lived in small communities. We produced what we needed, and that was it, right? We produced to meet our own needs. When the industrial era really started to take root and grow, we separated our role as producer and consumer. And as the producer, we created this concept of work. Work became valuable. Work became hierarchical. It was all about your success at work. Now we are reconfiguring what does it mean to be human and allowing us to reattach these concepts again to imagine what does value come from? What does worth come from? And the concept of being able to provide for yourself versus I have to go get a job are two very different things, right? I can provide for myself and my family a million different ways, right? I could go and start planting things in my backyard and have a goat and chickens and learn how to kill them and cook from the table. Or I could go and drive for Uber, or I could start a company. There's a million different ways to do that. But we've never taught the framework because we've never thought about that framework. We're coming at this transition saying, we need to figure out who those new companies are and what those new jobs are that people are going to take. And that's the wrong question. That's the wrong set of assumptions, right? And to put it in startup language, like when we meet a startup founder, a startup is nothing but a bundle of assumptions. And the task at hand is to separate assumption from fact. And every single assumption has to be tested and validated. And that's exactly what we have to do right now. What are the assumptions we have in place? We're assuming we have a federal government. We're assuming there's a role for state and city government. We're assuming there are big employers. We're assuming we have this thing called a job. Are those still true in the future? We've got to do a lot of reimagining because this future is not going to look anything like the last 100 years.
So I want to push back a little bit on your assumption, maybe to be the naysayer at the table. So I agree that we are rethinking what a job means. But what will remain forever true is that people need to find some way to productively employ is even the wrong word. This language trap is terrible. But to productively utilize their skills and talents in a way that allows them to, in some way, get some resources to take care of them and their family and be, you know, involved to whatever extent they want in their community, that's not going away.
That is the assumption I'm questioning.
So I,
you know, so we
right.
That is, in fact, the question I'm asking, whether that assumption is safe.
So I don't think that we're moving into a sort of, I don't know, utopian Star Trek future where, like, money doesn't exist or there's no, scarcity is a thing. People need resources to value scarce goods appropriate. I like capitalism, I guess, in a nutshell. And I think that the signaling in an economy that happens through money, that comes from jobs, maybe my blinds are on a little bit too much. But I do think that what's interesting in your question is that so many people are spending a lot of time thinking about what the jobs of tomorrow are going to be, whereas 50 years ago, we couldn't have said what the jobs of today were going to look like. 100 years ago, we certainly couldn't have said that. And in the early 1700s, 90% of our population was employed in agriculture, right? As of 1870, I think it was still 50%, right? And so while we do know, I think it is safe to say there will be some version of this thing called a job. What that is going to be, we can't in any way be prescriptive about. And that's what I've kind of loved about the overall theme of this panel, is that to me then, the way to not be overly prescriptive about that and push people in one direction or the other, whether it's coding or this or that or working on the machines, is just to get back to some basic tenets of freedom, right? Like what I worry about in this age of transition more than any age of transition in the past is that we live in one where we are overly regulated, where it's hard to get access to capital, where it's hard to start out and try your own thing. And I worry that we limit ourselves from being able to create the occupations that we could otherwise create in a very brilliant future that will be advanced by all of the technologies we're developing today. What if those jobs don't come because government stood in the way and didn't allow us to, you know, create and think about what those things were going to look like and then carry out those visions to reality? That's more of my worry, because I don't want to be prescriptive about what I think the jobs will be. I think this technology is going to take us in places where 20 years from now, my son will be sitting on this panel and he'll be talking about what things were like back in his mom's day when she was on this panel. And I want that future to happen. And so I think we need to focus more on reducing barriers to trying new things, because I don't know what they'll look like.
By the way, Tim Lorden will be running that panel.
God, I hope not.
Next question. One of the things I've noticed is that, according to analysis, that this dislocation disproportionately impacts jobs held by female workers, yet all the questions today have been asked by men, and the only hands up are male. Does that tell us something?
I'm not shocked by that.
We have very smart women on the panel.
There we go. Blue sweater, please.
Flip side of this, flip side of lower employment and every job being done by a robot is hopefully there will be a lower cost of living. Do you see that being the responsibility of government? Will capitalism take care of it? How do we get there so that if fewer people have work or they're making less money, that they can afford to continue to live?
So I don't think we have to make the assumption that fewer people will be working. I think hopefully the whole point of the panel is to figure out and illuminate ways in which we can keep people working in whatever we want to decide the word work and job means as a group in this room today. I do think that, yes, things stand to become dramatically cheaper. I mean, that tends to happen over time anyways. As technology develops, we now have all sorts of cool things standard in our house that we never did before. You know, what my son, again, will have in his house is completely different than what I have today. And so I think that in many ways has obviously already reduced a huge burden. It's so much easier not that it's ever easy. I don't mean this to in any way come off as an insensitive comment, right? But a poor person today has more than a poor person before. A poor person in America has more than a person who lives in poverty in a third world country. And obviously we want to continue to improve those standards of living, but it is still just on face, it's true. Right. And so I do think that's one of the big promises is as everything becomes cheaper, then we can use capital productively elsewhere. Right. That's why trade is good. It's why technological advancement is good. And so I think it's important for us to defend those things. If we want to be defenders of people who need a higher standard of living, we need to defend cheaper technology in the future. And we need to defend the flow of goods and services across borders that allow them to access the goods that they need at a price they can afford.
I know we focus on things that are, you know, 20 years out and talk about 30 years out, but I'm really looking at 4 to 8 years out. You know, a lot can happen, as we've seen, in 8 years. And the animosity that we've seen in this past election in the United States, the animosity you see around the world, you see BRICS, you see a bunch of situations that are arising in the next, you know, decade. That's why I think we need to start looking at this kind of a little bit short term as well. It's great to look, I mean, I was on a panel with a gentleman from Bell Labs who had a beautiful vision of the future with 5G. It was just, I mean, it was great, and 3D printers and localization. It was a great presentation. It's on the IIC website, so I highly recommend that you view it. But I also, you know, saw one of the best papers that the Obama administration has come out with, which unfortunately came out on December 20th, dealing with the impact of artificial intelligence on the job market. Has anybody here, have you all read it? I highly recommend, and we need to disseminate that, because it's a great starting point. I don't agree with all the recommendations, but it's a great starting point. The other really great read is the Software Information and Industry Association's white paper on AI as well. Those two papers, I think, really give us a starting point to look at in a very comprehensive and easy-to-read manner and to start the discussion. But I think 10, you know, looking 20 years from now is wonderful. And to your question, John, I think looking at those things as we're going forward, but I think we have an immediate 4 to 8 year problem that if we don't address it, we could have some real chaos on our hands in, as we like to say, across the country.
So we've got time for two more questions. I think our most patient have been Steve and Joel up here, so.
Thanks, Steve DelBianco with NetChoice. Rick, the weatherman, is warning of us a coming storm, and Donna says, don't trust our institutions to help us weather the storm. But in the immediate short run, we actually have organizing entities present today, and they are internet-based marketplaces, platforms that connect buyers and sellers peer-to-peer. And a number of you have talked about the gig economy, Lyft, Uber, TaskRabbit. That's only one third of what the internet platform economy is, because it's not about occupations, it's about economic opportunity. I would ask you what you think of the other two thirds of the peer-to-peer platform economy, one being the goods economy, that I'm making something in my small town in Iowa, but now I can reach a marketplace around the world on Amazon, Etsy, or eBay. And the third is the notion of I've got assets that I can charge people to use when I'm not using them, or fix up other assets and charge others. Airbnb, HomeAway, Turo, folks who rent their delivery van on days they're not using it. So those three elements are all part of the peer-to-peer economy. It's not an institution, Donna, but it's an organizing entity that is present today and should be experimenting with ways to provide these people with more economic opportunity.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And I used the term community with a little C earlier, right? When we talk about communities, we tend to think about geographical boundaries, cities, counties, states, and it shouldn't be. A community, when we talk about that, that could be Etsy, that could be Uber, that could be Airbnb, that could be the platform that someone's cooking up in their garage that we haven't even heard of yet. And that's the wonderful part about what's going on, is that it creates the power of the network, so that whatever skill I have, whatever good I have, whatever property I have, whatever passion I have, it creates a way for me to bring that gift out to the marketplace and have reach. Now, there are interesting ways that that's being monetized. In some cases, that is the exchange of money. In other cases, we're seeing bartering going on, where we're actually eliminating the concept of currency, right? The currency becomes the barter of the good or service. And so, you know, I think that it isn't saying we're going to not have any organizing entities at all. What I am saying is that the entities that we have over the last 100 years just assumed are at the center of everything, the federal government, the state government, the city government, the big employer, a la corporation that I go work as a W-2 employee for, or unions or churches, these things may or may not become obsolete. But what we do know for sure is the rise of these communities with a small c that allow us to connect in ways that the industrial era did not allow us, right? It was a very siloed era. And we're breaking down all those boundaries in a way that allow us to reconnect And by the way, those connections operate a lot like a giant mesh network. So I can connect with you one way today and a different way tomorrow. And I can connect with these people over here and those people over there. And when that community is no longer of interest, I can connect over here, right? And so the analogy is a mesh network as opposed to an institutional center for the economy.
Let's try to fit in Joel's question.
Thanks, Joel Usher, Congressional Fellow from Tech Congress. I think both implicit and explicit in a lot of your comments have been the role in businesses and industry in advancing these experiments or kind of worker-focused reforms that are going to help change the future of work. But if we look at the if we look at the kind of track record of industry in America, we see suppression of maybe climate data by the extractive industries, health data by big tobacco. What gives you faith in industry as a cooperative partner with society to advance something that's not just about the bottom line and shareholder value? And then what do you see as the role in either incentivizing or compelling businesses, kind of whether you're conservative or liberal ideologically, to accomplish these goals?
Thank you. I think one of the things that you see in certainly the on-demand economy and some of the contingent workforce is that there's a built-in feedback mechanism because they need to be recruiting the people who work with and on the platforms at the same time. So, and the forcing mechanism of having Uber think about the plight of its drivers is that its drivers, it has to be able to recruit enough drivers to drive for the service. Until they're replaced, but even true for the transportation industry, but even for many of the different industries that we see emerging now, there's a lack of because it's not an authoritative setup the way that our institutions and corporations used to be set up of boss versus worker. It's not an inherently adversarial process anymore, and because of that you see more collaboration, and I think because of that there's more incentive to think through this problem in advance.
I work for the U.S. Chamber, and I have a big believer in capitalism and businesses stepping up, but you know, we keep hearing about the market economy and the peer-to-peer market and everything else. There are large corporations that run that. I mean, Amazon is massive. You know, Google is incredibly massive. You look at a merger, AT&T and Time Warner merger, that's this mega merger, will still only be 50% the size of an Apple or an Amazon or a Google. And yet that's a mega merger with a lot of employees. And so, you know, we do have to have, I don't think government's gonna ever go away. I have this argument all the time about ICANN and internet governance. You know, the fact that governments are gonna go away just isn't going to happen. We need them to do the right thing. It has to be rational, it has to be balanced. It can't be over-restrictive. I think the licensing idea is truly, occupational licensing reform is huge, so you can move and migrate across state lines and have businesses that go across state lines. Steve and I worked a long time at Del Bianco on internet tax issues. You know, we've all done these issues. But I do think that we are working for the man. We are working, you know, as one who comes from a corporation that's very large, I can tell you the intimidation of other large companies and how we acted. And we're a mega corporation, 21st Century Fox. And so don't underestimate the power of that, you know, hyper network effect of getting your businesses and your products out into the, if one or two or four companies are controlling that, it may not be a government, but what is being dictated to you is the corporate policies that are just sometimes can be harmful. So we need to make sure that we're balancing those interests. Because my livelihood is based on one company, and that I guarantee you I am not going to tick that company off again. I've seen it with my own company who took certain steps because of being fearful of what were the ramifications from that far larger corporation.
So one thought, and I'll go quickly because I know that we're getting short on time. So I understand the skepticism. I mean, part of my comments were about how I don't think business has stepped up quite enough, particularly in upskilling and making sure that they're investing in their workforce. But I do think that we see room for hope, right, in that space. There's been a lot of growth in innovative partnerships, whether with technical colleges or community colleges or high schools. I think that the labor shortage in and of itself has put corporations to some extent in a place where they feel like it is in the best interest of their bottom line. I could have a whole separate conversation with you about corporate governance and short-termism, but that's beyond the scope right now. So I think that there's growth there already. Some of that's been incentivized by the federal government, but some of it's been driven just by businesses themselves working with their local communities. I think that in particular, in the case of the sharing economy, the threat of the lawsuit and the ability to experiment and find something that works for them in the future is probably incentive enough to want to get it right. And I hope that I am right in that assertion, that they will continue to be active players in that discussion, because it's a this isn't a place where they need incentives, right? If they lose some of those lawsuits, then it's done, right? It's a done deal, and their company can't even exist anymore under its current structure. And would it be profitable in the new one? Who knows? So I think that in that case, that there's already sort of an incentive enough to get it right.
So with that, we've cut into the break a little bit. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you to the panel for this conversation.
Here. Extremism? I thought that was this panel.